I had the perfect life. My parents adored me, I had tons of friends, and my boyfriend Alec was the hottest guy in school. He was the captain of the football team, and he drove a shiny new car. Every time he drove me to school, I saw a few girls turn green. I feel sorry for them. How did they even live? Everyone loved me, except for my little sister Ivy. I don't know what her problem was. Between you and me, I thought she was jealous. A few times I caught her in my bedroom trying on my clothes. Then there's that time I saw her drooling at Alex when he came over to swim in our pool. Ugh. As if he could even look at her twice. I bet he didn't even know she existed. Ivy and I look nothing alike. I was tall with naturally blonde hair. She was a brunette and her weight was average. So was everything else about her. That's why what she did next took everyone by surprise. Wanna know what she did? Watch and find out. It was the last weekend of summer break. I'd just returned home from being away all summer and I couldn't wait to see my boyfriend Alex again. I bet he'd miss me. Correction, I know he missed me. Why else would he be throwing me a surprise welcome party at his house? I wasn't supposed to know, but my best friend Olivia was the biggest gossip in school. I'd just finished getting ready when my mom announced that Alex had arrived. His timing was perfect. I even practiced my surprise face for when we arrived at his house for the party. Alex! Did you miss me? I bet… no. This couldn't be happening. Was this some kind of sick joke? Alex was standing in our living room, kissing Ivy! Alex, what are you doing?
Emily, I'm so sorry. This is not how I wanted you to find out.
Find out what?
That he's my boyfriend now. Sorry, big sis. I thought your loudmouth BFF already told you. My bad.
Come on, this isn't funny. Alex, let's go. Ivy, find a hobby or something. That was so gross. Alex didn't even turn to look at me. He took Ivy's hand and walked out of the door with her. The last thing he said before closing it was that he was sorry. What just happened? I called Alex, but he didn't pick up, so I called Olivia.
I was going to tell you, I swear. When I heard about the party he was hosting for you, I thought he had finally come to his senses.
I don't think that party was ever for me. He just left with Ivy. He kissed her, Liv.
I know. Half the school is at his house. Em, the party is for their 1 month anniversary.
This was a nightmare. I ran back to my room and I fell down on my bed. I cried for hours. Senior year was going to suck. On Monday morning, Ivy and I sat with my mom for breakfast. I'd locked myself in my room all weekend and hadn't seen Ivy since the day of the party. I couldn't sit near her without wanting to rip her hair out. Just pack mine to go, Mom. I've lost my appetite.
Sure thing, honey.
Hey, Mom, I want to move into Emily's room. Mine's too small now that my boyfriend and my friends come over a lot. Also, I want to use my room to store my new clothes and bags.
Of course, dear. Emily will move her things after school.
What? Mom, please tell me you're joking. It's my room. But she wasn't. When I got home from school, I found Mom packing my stuff as Dad carried them down to the basement. Ivy was watching, arms across her chest and a smile on her face. I'm going to kill you. I lunged at Ivy, but my mom stepped between us.
That's enough from you, Emily. What has gotten into you?
I couldn't believe what I was hearing. First my boyfriend, and now my room? Turns out this was just the tip of a very big Ivy-shaped iceberg. I was the talk of the school all week. I was the poor girl who lost her boyfriend to her little sister. Alex avoided me, and so did most of my friends. Ivy dyed her hair blonde, exactly like mine. She replaced her large eyeglasses with contacts. She wore expensive clothes and jewelry. Where was she getting all of this stuff? The allowance our parents gave us definitely wasn't enough.
You're staring.
Olivia sat next to me in the cafeteria. Ivy was eating her lunch while a girl standing next to her held her bag and her phone for her. I'm sorry, I can't help this. This is ridiculous. How is she getting away with all of this? Isn't that Amy, the head cheerleader? She's the most popular girl in Ivy's class. A few weeks ago, Ivy wouldn't have gone near her. Now she's holding Ivy's bag while she eats. Just then, a woman I'd never seen before walked into the cafeteria and to Ivy's table.
You!
She was looking right at Ivy.
I don't know what game you're playing, but stay away from me and my fiancé.
She turned to Amy.
And you, stay away from my fiancé.
Then she grabbed Ivy's necklace and ripped it from her neck. She then took Ivy's water and threw it in Amy's face. Before anyone could react, she walked out, Ivy's necklace in her hand. What was that all about?
That's Michelle, Mr. Wells' fiancé.
Wells? The math teacher?
Yep.
Olivia feigned boredom, but I knew she was hiding something and was dying to tell me. I sat and waited.
Fine, I'll tell you. So get this. All through summer break, there was a rumor that Mr. Wells was involved with a student. Most of us suspected Amy was the student, but we never knew for sure. I guess now we know.
Well, at least they're of age, but still. Ew. They must be like 20 years younger.
I know.
Why did she also attack Ivy?
Who knows? Ivy is the devil nowadays. Probably did something to Mr. Wells.
As weeks went by, I noticed that Amy wasn't the only one under Ivy's command. Ivy had her own little army of minions. They ran around her like clockwork, picking up after her and making sure she had anything she asked for. I once saw a girl remove her earrings from her own ears and offer them to Ivy. She even had a senior doing her assignments. I saw her stand over him while he did her math homework. After he was done, he handed the books to her and she told him, "Same time tomorrow." At home, she became impossible to live with. She made my mom clean her rooms. She went out every night and whenever I reported her, Mom and Dad ignored me. She asked Dad for the latest iPhone and he bought it for her. She decided what we ate. If she was in the mood for pizza, then we'd all have to eat pizza. One evening, she asked Mom to bake her favorite chocolate cake. Mom spent hours baking. When she was done, Ivy said she'd changed her mind. Mom was close to tears. I had to know how she was getting away with this. Why were people granting her all of her wishes? A few days later, Alex came to our house. He said a quick hello and then rushed to Ivy's room. I followed him and stood outside the door listening.
I can't do this anymore, Ivy. I'm done playing your games. I'm going to tell Emily everything.
Go ahead. Tell her. See if she'll take you back. She'll never forgive you.
She might not forgive me, but at least I'll be free from you.
You'll be free when I say you're free. I own you, Alex. Unless you no longer want that football scholarship?
Of course I do.
That's what I thought. Now be a good boyfriend and come paint my toenails. I'm in the mood for silver today, to match with the silver bracelet you got me yesterday.
I waited for Alex to leave, then followed him to his house. Alex, wait up. He had just parked his car.
Em, what are you doing here?
I overheard you and Ivy. Alex, what's going on?
She made me swear not to tell you. If I do, then my life is over.
What does she have on you? I promise not to tell. You can trust me. It took a bit more convincing, but Alex finally told me the truth.
Ivy caught me opening the exam cabinet just before we took the end of junior year tests.
Alex told me how he got the key to the cabinet from a boy in his class. You paid him?
Not really. He gave me the key after I promised to invite him to parties and introduce him to girls. He's kind of... let's just say he needed my help.
Alex told me how he went into the school at night planning to access the cabinet and copy test answers. Ivy saw him and followed him. When she caught him, she threatened to report him. Alex begged her not to. He told her that if she reported him, he'd get suspended, or worse. He was hoping to get a football scholarship at the end of the senior year, and Ivy knew this.
So she asked me to be her boyfriend. I told her to ask for anything else, but her mind was set. Part of my deal with her is making you suffer as much as possible by letting you think that I chose her over you. If she finds out that I told you the truth, she'll report me to the principal. I can't get suspended in my senior year.
I was relieved that Alex was not Ivy's boyfriend by choice. Just tell the principal that you went there intending to copy the answers but changed your mind the last minute. I doubt he'll suspend his best quarterback for that.
Em, I didn't tell you everything. After I agreed to become her boyfriend, Ivy helped me copy the test answers. She's holding that over my head too. Your sister is devious, Em.
The weeks that followed, I found out just how devious Ivy was. Remember the senior that was doing her assignments? He was the boy that gave Alex the keys to the cabinet. His mom was a teacher at Oakley High and he stole the keys from her. Ivy got Alex to tell her all of this and then threatened to report the senior too. So now he was stuck doing her assignments. One evening, I got home and found Mom crying. Mom, what's wrong? Did something happen to Dad? Mom looked so sad and exhausted.
It's your sister. Emily, I have to tell you something. Ivy, she knows something she shouldn't. She found out that I'm... Your dad and I are not your parents.
What?
Sit down, honey. Let's wait for your, dad to get home.
No, what do you mean you're not my parents? I'm adopted?
Not exactly. Your Aunt Martha, my sister who died in a car crash with her husband, those were your parents. You were in the car with them, but you were not hurt.
I was in tears, and so was my mom. She tearfully recounted finding me with nurses at the hospital when she got news of the crash. Martha was in critical condition, but her husband, my father, was dead. Before she died, Martha asked Mom to raise me as her own and to never tell me about their tragic death.
So we took you home and never spoke of the accident again. Ivy found a box with old photos of you with them. She also found newspaper articles about the crash. She threatened to tell you. I begged her not to be so cruel, but she just laughed. She has the box hidden in her room. I was so afraid you'd hate us if you found out. She made us kick you out of your room. She has been asking for so many things from your dad and me. We have spent so much money buying her new clothes and other things. I'm so sorry, dear.
I was super sad after my talk with Mom, but I was not going to let Ivy win. It was time to end her reign as the evil queen. When our doorbell rang, I thought I'd finally get to confront Ivy. But it wasn't Ivy at the door.
Is this the Gilligan residence?
That's my dad, yeah.
My name is Officer Bridges. Are your parents home? I need them to come to the station.
Less than an hour later, we were at the station. Mom had called Dad on the way and he met us there. The officer told us that Ivy had been arrested for possession of stolen property. We found Ivy in tears.
I keep telling them that this is not my bag, but they won't believe me. Amy gave it to me.
Mr. and Mrs. Gilligan, your daughter is lying. Amy Smith is the one that told the manager where to find the missing bag. We have the manager's statement right here.
It looks like Amy set you up, Ivy. What did you do to her? Hours later, we were all back home. Ivy had been released with a warning to stay out of trouble. Turns out, Amy had shoplifted the bag and given it to Ivy. Then she'd gone back to the store and told them that Ivy was the shoplifter.
Why would she do such a thing?
I caught Amy kissing Mr. Wells. I threatened to report them to the principal and Mr. Wells' fiancé unless they did what I asked.
So Ivy had made Amy her slave. She made Amy carry her bags around school, and she also took Amy's diamond necklace that Amy had received from Mr. Wells. So that's why Mr. Wells' fiancé ripped it from your neck.
Yes.
As for Wells, he had to give her A's in all of her math classes. Are you the one that got him fired?
What? No! He quit after he confessed to his fiancé about his affair with Amy.
Why did you do all of these things?
I wanted to know how it feels to have everything, like you did.
Guilt overcame me. I'd made my sister feel ignored and alone, and this drove her to manipulation and blackmail. Even though I was angry with her, I promised to be a better big sister. My parents told Ivy to return all of the items they'd bought for her. They also told her to move out of my room. Alex reported himself to the principal and he got suspended. We never got back together.
Tonight is beautiful. I held Tegan's hand as we looked up at the stars from the back porch swing. Suddenly, the door opened and Mr. Nelson, without a word, grabbed Tegan's arm and dragged her inside. I sprang into action and ran behind them. I held on to Mr. Nelson's arm just before it came crashing down on Tegan. Mr. Nelson turned to me and snarled. He grabbed a handful of my clothing in his large hand and lifted me above the floor and threw me through the front door. Tegan screamed as Mr. Nelson came after me on the lawn.
James, please just go. I'll be okay.
Feeling defeated, I held my ribs as I hobbled to my car. Whether Mr. Nelson knew it or not, this was not the end of it. If you want to see how I dealt with Mr. Nelson for his hospitality, keep watching till the end of the video. Luckily for me, I was able to drive myself to the hospital where I called my parents and told them where I was.
What happened?
Mom and Dad rushed into the hospital room just as I was pulling my t-shirt on.
Your son will be fine,
Dr. King said.
A few bruised ribs, but in a few days he'll be okay.
Bruised ribs?
Mom gasped and looked at me wide-eyed. Someone tried to rob me on the way home, but I was able to get away. Mom hugged me tightly and cried.
Paula?
Dad looked at my reddened face.
You're suffocating the boy.
Mom removed her arms hesitantly. Dad turned to Dr. King.
Can he go home now?
Yes, he's free to leave.
I thanked Mr. King, and my parents and I left the hospital. I drove with Dad, and Mom drove my car. I was happy Dad suggested I drive with him. At least for now, I got away from Mom's 20-question scenario. As soon as I got home, I tried to call Tegan, but I only got her voicemail. I wasn't about to let Mr. Nelson ill-treat her or her younger siblings anymore. It was time someone taught that bully a lesson. Before I continue, let me start at the beginning. It all started with pizza. Pizza is my number one fast food go-to. I ordered pizza at least 4 times a week. Orlando, my normal pizza guy, would usually stick around for a slice or two before leaving. However, one afternoon, Orlando didn't show. Instead, when I opened the door, before me stood a tall, slender, long-haired brunette with the most gorgeous sapphire eyes.
That will be $24, sir.
She stared at me. I cleared my throat. Sure. I handed her the money. Where's Orlando? She shrugged.
I don't know. I just deliver pizzas.
I thanked her and closed the door. I ordered pizzas for the next 14 days just to see her. She told me that her name was Tegan. It was almost a month before I asked her if I could take her out on a date. It took another month before she said yes. Over the next few months, I found out that Tegan's mother died. She and her younger siblings, Monique and Josiah, now lived with their dad. While Tegan worked to bring in money for the household and take care of her family, her dad sat around the house watching TV. Why don't you leave? I asked her one evening while we were having dinner.
Well, I can't just leave my siblings and my father will come looking for us. I'll stay and protect them until they are of age to leave. Besides, I promised Mom on her deathbed to look out for my siblings, and I always keep my promises.
I sighed heavily. If you ever change your mind, you know I'm here for you. Tegan nodded, but didn't say anything for a few seconds.
Dad wasn't always like that. He was loving when Mom was around. Dad is dealing with Mom's loss just as I am. He's just dealing with it in his own way.
And back to the present. Later that night, as I prepared for bed, I knew I had to do something to help Tegan and her siblings. I mean, isn't that what boyfriends are supposed to do to make things easier? I wasn't totally truthful to Tegan about my past and why my parents and I had moved. The truth is, and it's even hard for me to admit it now, I was in a gang. My parents thought it was best for us to move when I was 15, and without the negative influences, maybe I'd be able to make something of myself. I finished school and I was in my last year of college. However, unknown to my parents, I kept in contact with a few of my past friends. The very next day, I contacted Yellows, one of the guys I kept in contact with, and I told him the situation. I told him I just needed him and a few of the guys to scare Tegan's father. I told them about the situation, and all I wanted was for them to scare the father into treating his children better. Yellows and I agreed that the scare tactic would occur the next night. My nerves were on edge the whole of the next day. I couldn't eat and I couldn't drink. I tried calling Tegan again and still no answer. I went to her workplace after class and she wasn't there. I went home that evening and sat on the sofa watching nothing in particular. It was around 10 p.m. on the late night news when a news reporter announced that a robbery had occurred at the Nelson residence. It was alleged that her father was beaten, items were stolen, and Tegan was kidnapped. Kidnapped? I flew up from the sofa and immediately grabbed my phone and called Yellows.
Yo, James, what's up?
Yellows responded from the other side. What in the world did you do? Kidnap? You kidnapped her?
Wait, what? Kidnapped who?
Yellows sounded confused. Tegan, I told you to scare Mr. Nelson, not kidnap Tegan.
James, we did not kidnap Tegan. We just roughed up her old man a bit and tied him up and left.
Turn on Channel 6 News now. The phone went silent for a few seconds before Yellows responded.
James, we've been friends for a long time. I'll never do anything to hurt your girl. Something must have gone down after we left.
I'll call you back. I hung up without waiting for Yellows to respond. Had I made things worse? If Yellows and the boys didn't do it, then what happened? After a week, Tegan was still missing and the police had no leads. I felt like I was losing my mind. Then it struck me. What if it wasn't Yellows? What if Mr. Nelson did something to Tegan and lied about it? I decided that the only way to get answers was to question Monique and Josiah. I waited for them outside their middle school. When they saw me, they hesitated and Josiah held Monique's hand. Hey guys, how are you? Just wanted to check up on you, I said as they passed me. Neither Josiah nor Monique answered. I walked beside them. Do you guys know where Tegan is? Monique looked at me. She looked as though she was about to answer when Josiah said annoyed.
We don't know where she is. We need to get home.
If your dad did anything to her, you could tell me. Josiah and Monique stopped and turned to me. Just then, a police car pulled up beside us, and the police officer turned to Monique and Josiah.
Kids, is this guy bothering you?
The officer shot me a stern look.
Yes, he is. May we have a drop home, please?
The officer got out of the car.
Sure, no problem.
He opened the back door, and the kids got in. As they drove off, I noticed Monique turned in the back seat and looked at me until the car was out of sight. I got an uneasy feeling in my stomach. My gut instinct told me that Monique and Josiah knew where Tegan was, but were too afraid to say. That night, I parked my car 2 blocks away from Tegan's house and walked the rest. I didn't want anyone to see my car. I wore dark clothes and a hoodie pulled over my face so I couldn't be noticed. I hid behind the bushes until I saw the last light in the house go off. I then waited another 15 minutes to make sure that everyone was asleep before I jimmied one of the windows and entered the living room. I allowed my eyes to get accustomed to the darkness since I didn't want to use a flashlight to make someone on the outside aware that I was in the house. First, I crept to Tegan's room. The scent of her filled my nostrils as soon as I entered. I missed her smile, her laughter, her kisses. I needed to get to the bottom of this quickly. I spent about 15 minutes in her room searching through her papers and cupboards, but came up barehanded. Maybe I should check the basement. If she's hidden, it has to be there, I mumbled to myself. I crept down to the basement and grimaced when the basement door creaked loudly as I opened it. I slid into the basement and left the door slightly ajar. While in the basement, I looked in cupboards. I noticed one cupboard in the corner was chained, and as I walked towards it, I tripped over a floorboard. I stooped and realized that the floorboard could move. Carefully, I placed my fingers under the floorboard and was about to lift it when I heard the floorboard creak behind me. As soon as I spun around, Mr. Nelson punched me in the jaw. I stumbled backwards and crashed into the floor. I blocked my face from Mr. Nelson's attacks until I was able to kick him in the stomach and get away. You killed her! You killed Tegan! I screamed. I tried to dodge around Mr. Nelson as I tried to escape, but he was a large man. He grabbed me by my shirt and dragged me up the stairs like a sack of potatoes. As I struggled against him, he got rope from below the kitchen sink, tied me up, and called the police. Sirens blared about 5 minutes later, and Mr. Nelson opened the door for them to come inside.
I found this boy snooping in my basement and I'd like to press charges,
Mr. Nelson smirked.
He killed Tegan. Tell them how you hid her below the floorboards in the basement, I yelled.
By this time, Josiah and Monique were awake and peeped from the doorway of their bedroom. One of the officers turned to Mr. Nelson.
Sir, would you like to tell us what this young man is babbling about?
Mr. Nelson looked at me. A wave of uneasiness washed over his face. I smiled.
Sir, we would like to see that basement.
The officer looked from me to Mr. Nelson. Untie me and I'll show you where it is. The senior officer instructed an officer to untie me. Mr. Nelson stepped towards me and the senior officer stood in front of him and placed his hand on his chest. Mr. Nelson stepped back.
Okay, son,
the senior officer said as I stood up.
Show us where the body is.
Gladly. I glared at Mr. Nelson and pushed past him and went to the basement. With the help of the officers, we removed some of the floorboards. What we saw next changed my life forever. Below the floorboards were beer bottles. The officers looked at me puzzled. Mr. Nelson spoke up.
After Tegan was kidnapped, I promised Monique and Josiah I would stop drinking. I hid these down here so the kids wouldn't see it. But sometimes it's so hard after losing my wife, now Tegan.
Mr. Nelson's voice crumbled to the end of his sentence. He walked back to the living room, followed by the officers and me. Needless to say, Mr. Nelson pressed charges for breaking and entering, and I was given a 1-year sentence with hard labor. Every day that I spent behind those prison walls, I thought about Tegan. I regretted the decision I made and wished I could change it. Living with that kind of regret took a toll on me mentally, physically, and emotionally, which caused me to lose a lot of weight in prison. My parents came to visit me as often as possible, and honestly, if it wasn't for them, I don't think I would have made it out alive. About 6 months into my sentencing, I was out on parole and was warned to stay away from Tegan's house. A few days after my release, while watching television with my parents, we heard sirens outside. Then someone banged on the door. Mom and Dad exchanged looks before Dad opened the front door.
Good evening, sir. Is James at home?
The officer that stood outside asked.
What's this about?
Is James at home? We'd like to question him.
About what?
I walked to the door and folded my arms. Talk to me about what?
Monique and Josiah Nelson have been kidnapped. Do you know anything about it?
Don't answer that,
Dad said.
We have been at home with James for the past 3 days. If you need further information, I will give you the number of our lawyer.
Dad stepped outside and closed the door behind him. Mom came and stood beside me and hugged me. I buried my head in her neck and allowed the tears to flow. I couldn't believe this was happening again. Over the next few days, I spoke with the family lawyer and the police. Dad even gave them home security footage to promise I was home during the time of the kidnapping. I was no longer a suspect, at least for now. One evening while I was home alone, someone knocked on the door. I opened the door, but no one was there. On the floor lay a package, which I picked up and took inside. It didn't have a name, a stamp, or a return address on it. In the box were memories that I had with Tegan, pictures, CDs, ticket stubs, and dried up roses. In the box was a letter written by Tegan, where she explained that the night her family was robbed, after the men left, she snuck away. Her father was unconscious, and she told Monique and Josiah that she would come back for them. She said that she and her siblings were now safe, and she hoped to see me again someday. My eyes filled with tears. After I read the letter, I burned it to protect their secret. I was happy she was free from her father, but I was sad that she didn't tell me about it earlier, even though I understood why she couldn't. I provided a way for her to be free, and now I'm at peace. It is better to have loved and lost than never to have loved at all.
What is wrong with you?
My parents screamed at me. They were sweating, their eyes were red, and they looked like they would pop out of their sockets in any second. My dad took a step closer. Oh my God, he's gonna hit me, I thought. I was trapped on a huge sofa and there was absolutely no means of escape. He took another step and this time, his face was right in front of mine. I could feel his hot, angry breath right on my face and I started shaking. I shook so much that you'd have thought I just came out of an ice-cold bath. He looked into my eyes with his red eyes. It almost looked like he was going to cry. After looking at me for a few seconds, my mom laid a hand on his shoulder.
Come into the room, sweetie. Let me get you a cup of lemon tea,
she said, trying to calm him down. My dad shook his head and started following my mom into their room. As he got to the staircase, he shook his head once more and muttered a few words that changed my life forever.
I can't even believe she's ours,
he said, looking at my mom. Like this video if you really want to know what happens next. Subscribe and turn on post notifications because even more crazy stuff is about to come. I didn't really care that my parents were angry. I was only scared that they'd hit me. Once they left for their room, I went straight to the refrigerator, grabbed a huge box of pizza, and started munching on it. I took it into my room, closed my massive doors, and blasted on my speakers. So Wet by Pink was the first song to play. It was almost like my speakers read my mind. I sang along. My parents would have disowned me if they could hear what I was singing at that point, after the massive scolding. You see, Fidelis, our neighbor's 17-year-old son, was a full brat. I gave him my phone to watch a short funny video on Facebook at school this morning, but Fidelis didn't bother telling me when he finished watching the video. Instead, he proceeded to my Photos app and started viewing my photos. He found a few of my private pictures. I sent these pictures to my ex a few months ago when I still thought he was going to be my future husband. It's not what you think, it's just a few pictures of me giving pouty lips and blowing kisses at the camera. But do you know what that brat Fidelis did after finding my pictures? He forwarded it to everyone in class! I came into my classroom after using the restroom and everyone applauded me. Then Dylan started to speak.
Nice pouty face, Susan.
And with that, everyone started clapping and whistling again, including full brat Fidelis and my ex-boyfriend. I decided not to give them the reaction they were hoping for, so I simply smiled, swung my hips, and replied, "You better believe it is." The whistles and applause intensified. My ex-boyfriend and Fidelis looked disappointed. They were hoping to push me to tears, but I surprised them. Luckily, my pictures never got to the school authorities, so I didn't face grave consequences. I collected my phone from Fidelis without uttering a word, then retreated to my seat. I went back home and behaved like everything was all right. Once the clock played its usual 11 p.m. alarm, I wore all black clothes and black sneakers, and then sneaked into Fidelis' house. I was armed with a few nails, a bat, and some crates of eggs. When I observed that the coast was clear, I went straight to work. I punctured the car tires of everyone in the house. Fidelis, his brother, and their parents. When I was sure that all the tires were just as flat and as empty as Fidelis' brain, I took the bat and broke the window on each car. I knew they'd soon hear the ruckus and come out to see, so I had to work fast. I threw eggs into every car until I was sure that they were all drenched. Whew! I sighed. My work was almost done and nobody had come out yet. Now that I was done with the eggs, I could break all the remaining windows and windscreens of all of their pathetic cars. I knew they'd wake up for sure this time, but I didn't care one bit. With all of my God-given strength, I started swinging. Fidelis' parents ran out and tried to stop me, but I think they were too scared of me to approach any closer. When they saw that they couldn't get across to me without hurting themselves, they called my parents to come and help. Fidelis' parents were just like him. Chickens! Scared of a little broken glass. My parents arrived in a few short minutes, but thankfully the deed was already done. I had achieved my goal. My parents apologized to Fidelis' parents and told them that they'd punish me while dragging me and my bleeding hands into our house. This is where you met me in the story. Punish me? I thought, yeah, right. My parents had tried every punishment possible on me, but it never stopped me from going crazy whenever I got angry. I tried everything to control my temper. My parents even registered me for therapy at one point, but the therapist annoyed me on a particular day, so I got angry and set her desk on fire right there and then. I did get arrested, but I was released quickly because I'm a minor. My parents had to pay an unreasonable amount of money for the loss of clients' files that I'd caused, so they grounded me for the rest of my life. I still went out a lot, though. They just didn't know about it. After classes the next day, it was lunchtime and I went to grab my usual. As I was walking to my cool girl table, a cute, scrawny-looking nerd approached me.
I heard what you did to Fidelis and his family,
he started.
You're a psychopath. Consider registering at a mental clinic before your case gets out of control.
What? What makes this nerd think he could even talk to me, much less give his opinion on my behavior? As he tried to walk away with his tray of food, I dragged him back by his neck and threw him onto the floor. I picked up both my food and his and emptied it on his face and body. My friends stood up from my table with their trays and emptied it on him too. Be careful who you talk to. The streets aren't nice, I said before walking away with my friends. I could hear him crying and sniffling as we walked off, but it only made us laugh harder. Turns out that the scrawny dude that I embarrassed and messed up was going to become my best friend and boyfriend eventually. I didn't know it at the time, and I wouldn't have believed it if someone else had told me. When it was almost time for a Christmas vacation, our high school hosted their signature Christmas blast. It was nothing short of amazing, as usual. Somehow, I got assigned to the drink-pouring committee as one of my punishments for my usual bad behavior. I heard sobs coming from the end of the hallway. I traced the sound and walked towards the noise until I found that annoying and disrespectful scrawny-looking dude again. Hey! Hey, get up! I gently tapped his shoulders. What's a man like you doing crying like a 2-month-old baby? I asked. He looked up and was about to talk when he got a clear view of my face. He did a double take and almost leaped backwards before saying,
Why don't you just leave me alone, psycho? You guys are all the same mentally unstable kids packed in one high school.
I rolled my eyes and started leaving, but I just couldn't. I went back to where he was sitting and sat down beside him. He looked more uncomfortable than I felt.
What are you doing?
He asked, eyes filled with disbelief. Just tell me what happened. I tried kindly, and that was when the scrawny dude, whose name was Jude apparently, started telling me the story of his life. I was trying to be a nice person, but I was already so bored. When will he finally get to the good part? I wondered. He finally did. Jude had been getting bullied by a group of three senior guys for years. He did their homework, ran errands for them, cleaned up their rooms, and even did their laundry. If he ever missed a day, they'd corner him and beat him up badly. Apparently, he had to spend some time with his sister in the hospital throughout last week, so he couldn't work for them. This annoyed them so much that they beat him up, broke his iPhone, and even destroyed the expensive suit he was wearing. They told him that he was being a bad boy and that he needed to change as soon as possible if he didn't want to experience that every week. Wait, what? I asked, astounded. What about their parents? Don't they know what's going on?
Some of them don't know. Others know, but just don't care,
he replied. Well, what about your parents? Have you told them what's going on?
I can't tell them about this, Susan. They already have enough to worry about.
I was fuming, but hearing my name from Jude's lips felt good. It had a nice ring to it. I have a plan. I was going to release scrawny Jude from his bondage, and my parents would finally feel proud that I was theirs. Jude and I came up with a plan to get those boys to confess. Jude would confront them, call them all sorts of names, and say he wasn't going to do any work for them anymore, making sure to list every single chore that he had been forced to do for years. I would hide in a locker, record everything, and send it to the school authorities. Our plan worked perfectly, and this was how Jude became my best friend. Unfortunately, something we couldn't foresee happened. One of those jerks had found out that I was the one who executed the plan that got them expelled and decided to leave a little gift for me before leaving school. On a dull, gloomy, and rainy morning, I woke up sad and angry, almost like I knew something bad was going to happen that day. Immediately, I got to school and I was called by the school officials. Apparently, one of those evil dudes had gotten a hold of my photos, which Fidelis leaked, and decided to get back at me by forwarding my indecent pictures to the school board. And guess who else? My red-eyed, head-shaking, disappointed parents. I knew I was going to be put in an orphanage at this point. There was no way my parents were going to take me home after that last straw had been pulled. I was suspended. You should know by now that I wasn't sorry. My parents didn't say anything on the ride home. I got home to see Jude waiting for us in the living room. Jude! I screamed as I ran and gave him a big hug. Where were you today? You won't believe what happened. I started narrating my ordeal to him.
It's okay, Susan. I know.
He gave me a sweet smile and a wink.
That's exactly why I'm here. I told your parents everything.
My dad finally spoke up.
Jude told us you got into trouble because you were saving him from bullying. We're not happy that you decided to take pictures for wayward teenage boys, and we're hoping you never do it again. But we're really proud of you. You're a good friend, and Jude is lucky to have you.
I almost shed tears. Does this mean you're happy I'm yours now?
Huh?
My dad asked, confused. The other day, you said you couldn't believe that I was...
No!
My dad cut me off.
Oh my god, I'm so sorry for saying something so mean to you. I let my anger take a hold of me. Susan, you're perfect. Yes, you have some anger issues, and of course we'd like to change that. But please bear in mind that we'll always love you no matter what.
My mom nodded in agreement. We all shared a hug and Jude stayed to eat dinner with us. By 9 p.m. when Jude was ready to go, I walked him to his car. He said, resting one hand on his scrawny car.
I want to tell you something, Susan.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead, I told him. He leaned forward and brushed his lips to mine.
I'm in love with you, Susan. Will you do me the honor of being my girlfriend?
He tried to give me a cool boy grin, but he failed. The grin was scrawny, just like him. Ew! I pushed him away. Heck no! Go home, Jude. He looked a little bit hurt, but I wasn't sorry. I was never sorry. He got into his car and sped off, as if he wanted to get as far away from me as possible. I went to my room, had a bath, and changed into my pajamas. I tried to go to bed, but I couldn't. Something was nagging at my chest. By 11 p.m., I snuck out of the house as usual and drove straight to Jude's house. I threw stones at his window until he noticed and came outside. Yes, I whispered.
Sorry, I don't think I quite got that.
He smiled. I'll be your girlfriend, Jude. Dating Jude absolutely changed me. He taught me how to control my bad temper and how to think clearly before making decisions. I stopped doing crazy things whenever I was angry, but I never stopped being a genius evil planner. Just ask Fidelis. Alright, now where did you think you were going? Come right back and hit the subscribe button and notification button. I know you enjoyed my story, so please give this video a like if you haven't already. That said, tell me if you've ever overreacted when angry, and what were the consequences of your actions? Did you end up feeling sorry?